Hello everyone, and welcome back to the Open Simulator Community Conference 2017. This is our fifth year for the conference, and we're celebrating 10 years of Open Simulator. Our 7 to 7:30 a.m. session is entitled Open Sim Technology, Opportunities or Obsolete, from an Industrial Perspective. And our speaker today is Frank Ruloff. Frank is a senior systems engineer at Thales Netherlands with expertise in training and simulation, leading the research and innovation activities related to open sim technology within the Thales Global Company. Frank, I pass the mic over to you. Thanks for joining us.
Okay, thank you, Michelle, for this invitation, and thank you, the community, for this invitation. What I would like to talk about a little bit is how, from an industrial perspective, we look at OpenSim and how to use it in our products. So, in basics, companies use technology for two things: they develop and sell new products, or they optimize their operational processes. With mostly as an objective to lower cost, so related to the price of the new products that is sold. With that perspective, it is looked at how you develop products and what markets and that sort of information. So what is the interest of Thales in the OpenSim technology? First of all, we see it as a collaboration platform. And we, as a global company, have a lot of multi-sites, national and international. So we see this as a collaboration platform in which we decrease cost or lower cost. And because we are international, there's also a traditional tools and methodology that increase cost. If we have design methodologies and we want to share that throughout the world, it's getting more cost associated with it. Also, risk increases, because dividing work over multiple sites around the globe will increase the risk. Another part is that we look at this technology for the reason of new training methodologies. In our field, and I'm working in the naval defense area, simulations training is done with very expensive machines and very expensive software packages, which take long to develop. And we see also that most defense organizations want a reducing cost. They also want to have individual training at any moment in time, and mostly our simulations and simulators are located in a fixed location. So that is one of the reasons why we also try to look at new ways to doing that. So what is the opportunity of OpenSim? What does it give us? It is a way to connect people virtually for collaboration. What's the cost? What's the thing behind it? It could decrease cost, mostly travel. And it decreases a risk and thus cost as well, because if you can go into a virtual world and talk with an engineer that is situated in the US or in Australia, then it's much simpler. It reduces risk. If you won't do that, you have to phone or you have to travel to it, and that won't happen because of the cost itself. So it also in decreases risk and thus the outlook of a better product. New training applications, less expensive, as already said, and no training, central training facilities, also meaning cost for travel, cost to operate it. And there are lots of other areas where we think it could be contributing to cost, operational cost, engineering, program management, product line management. So if we look at some examples, this is an example of general collaboration, having meetings with people from various subsidiaries all over the world, coming together to discuss and find solutions, innovative or whatever. We use for that a number of of tools that we have developed through time. We have the equivalent of what you see here as a presentation screen, but then we load our documents and presentations and drawings into a website, which then automatically will convert it and put it in world on the screens if we want to. We use a voice over IP server based on Murmur. We also use VFox for a while, but if we want to sell it to customers in our product line, they will not accept their audio going over a server from VFox in the United States. So we have our own solution for that. So this is another thing that we use. We use whiteboards so that we can collaborate between a number of people. A real whiteboard with stickers, with drawings you can make on it. We have, of course, web access, but we also have screen sharing so that people can share their screens between the visitors. The other thing that we do is in the line of the training, we also try to get the models of our systems into the virtual world so that we can design training around it for maintenance and so on. This is an area that is still one that needs to be developed, because the process going from the CAD/CAM models into a model that is suitable to be in world is not an easy one, and we need to find out how we can make that as efficient as possible. Here you see some other examples. This is a virtual training center that we created, and we do experiments with, so that we can try to find out what is good to do training for our customers, and how they can fit, and how we can optimize this experience for them in order to give small training to them through virtual worlds, and not needed to to travel to our facility to have the training. This is another example that we do. We made a command and control center to see if we could in the future create training for command and control using this kind of virtual training centers. So, what are the current activities that we are doing? We've been working at the moment. We are working. My team is working on the LSL editor. I think you probably all know it. It's the one that I think is commonly used. We will extend it. We will bring in all the open SIM primitives into the viewer, and we will also include new functionality in order to have a sort of include facility, so that you can include parts of scripts from other files into your work. The work on this is nearly done, and that will be released to open source, I think, in January or so. We are in the final stages of testing and reviewing the documentation, the manuals that are with there, and then it will be released in open source. The other thing is that we want to create a better remote desktop. And another very important thing, and I talk about that a lot of times in other places during the conference, is that we are working on a simplified viewer, because that is exactly what is needed by the users, and what a big comments we have from our users. So, and now let's talk a little bit about user experience. What we see, I've been busy with this for about 6 years, and all the experiments that we see that there are some psychological thresholds, and then you must see that there is the population is the people that have never experienced working with a open SIM type of virtual world. And then you see that age plays a role, because elderly people see this not as serious. They first start seeing this as a game. And while this cannot be serious, should we do something with that? Is then the question. And we also see that if you give presentations about it, they say, yeah, it's nice, and then they leave it. If you give a demonstration, they say, oh, it's nice and it's nicer. But they really go into work on it, people, when they are to really use it. And when they really use it, they mostly say, hey, this is very interesting. I see an advantage in using it. So there is a sort of psychological threshold that holds people back to use it. The other thing that is from a user experience point of view, comments we had is, okay, this is a lot of problem to install it, to get it running. The audio is always a problem to get it right the first time. And when we want to integrate it into our larger network of systems, security plays an important role. And the security, for instance, is something that already holds distributing the OpenSIM over the Thales corporate network for 3 years because of that. So another set of user experience. Most people who work for the first time with OpenSIM find the viewer too complicated. Some other remarks. They don't see use in flying or walking. Why do we need an avatar? Well, this is a little bit of a silly remark, of course, because if you don't have an avatar, you don't see the other person you're talking with, but okay. Missing integration with office suites or other outside tools. The graphical look and feel. They get spoiled by the nice games, and they get spoiled by the HoloLenses and say, well, it's not so nice. The fact that we cannot reach tablets, and also the use of 3D headset. We did experiments with 3D headset, and that didn't work really well, because okay, we have the nice work of somebody who tried to modify the viewer for the Oculus Rift, but in fact, the frame rate does not really allow to work it correctly. You need to create a whole new viewer to do that right, I think. The other point is that the presentation screens and the text on it was not very well readable with an Oculus Rift at that time. So we didn't continue that way because, well, that was one of our basic things. Now, if we look to user experience in the other sense, is that there is a lot of competition using headsets, using artificial intelligence, using high density graphics, which move people away from the real benefits of this technology, which is you can access it anytime, any place where you are. You can cooperate over the whole world in an easy way. You only need your laptop. You don't need rooms with sensors, or you don't need special expensive headsets and so on. But yes, the other thing looks a little bit nicer and it looks better. The focus on augmented reality, this is one of the things that draws the attention away from what we have as well. So to make it so, the point here is, how can we bring OpenSIM to a point, and the viewers together, because it's a package, of course, to a point that they are in line with the other technologies, like AR, like VR with headsets. One of the things that open source itself, OpenSIM itself could look at, is security aspects. Because we are not a military organization, but our security regulations are that heavy that we cannot deploy OpenSIM on our corporate network system at the moment. And that is also something that is heard by a lot of other companies that are not defense companies, but still have a very tight security. And OpenSIM needs more or less to get closer to be able to use it. Make installation simpler. We thought of web-based viewers. We also thought of server rendering so that the the rendering of happens in the server and not on the local PC or the local laptop. It also helps to bring it to the tablet if you want to do it. A simplified view for users. We have been working now on it. We try to convert a singularity viewer to a simple viewer and do experiments with that. Enhance interoperability. So make the APIs to access parts on access parts of OpenSim so that it can cooperate with other packages. Document it, make it more open so that people can try to integrate things and make larger applications of it. The other thing I would be good is to have a clear roadmap and an organization that supports and allows others to participate. We have the IMA, other organizations that maybe can play a role in building a roadmap and finding other organizations that would help in development and do things to bring OpenSim and the viewers further on. and one thing is important, try to implement industrial standards as much as possible, because then the interoperability between other packages would help. So this comes to my the end of my presentation. And again, I think that OpenSim has much more potential than it gets at the moment. But from an industrial point of view, it must be attractive to get profit, to optimize optimize processes, and to make new products. Thank you very much.
And thank you, Frank, for a fantastic presentation. We do have time for a few questions. If anyone has a question, I see Steve would like to know if your slides are going to be available later, and I can tell you that we will put slides up on the conference website so that people can get a hold of them.
Yeah, I see a question about the audio. As some of you know, VCOM, a company in Switzerland, was the one that once tried to produce a murmur-based voice of IP for Second Life. We asked them to create a murmur-based version for us, and we work together with them, and they will bring that version to open source as well. That will also happen in that's one of our conditions to let them work on it, and it will go to open source in January as well.
Oh, great, fantastic. Lear is asking to define remote desktop.
Well, remote desktop is that somebody's desktop somewhere in the world can be shown in world for all participants.
Okay. And then, let's see, Neo Bird says, could you say more about the security requirements, e.g. VPNs, authentications, etc., please?
Yes, we did. We did a test with VPNs, in the current setup, viewer and server, and that works fine with OpenSim. But our company has a lot of our corporate has a lot of additional policies and security policies to which an application must comply. Like open source, they want to be sure that there are no back doors in it and so on and so on. So it has to go through a whole lot of tests and validations before they allow it to get it on the internet. So it's the fact that we use the UDP, for instance, TCP is okay, but UDP could be a problem from the perspective of the security people.
Okay.
I see. How simple is a simple viewer?
Right.
Well,
last question.
Yeah. Okay. Well, a simple viewer. That means the people that give this sort of commands are people that come for using this for the first time, and for the first time it means they get a little bit of training, but then they go to the viewer and see all these buttons and all these things. So simple in my case is the navigation and a few very simple things that they can do.
Fantastic. And Frank, will you be here a little bit longer afterwards if people have further questions?
Yes, I will be the whole conference. I will be here.
Okay, so you can look for Frank. Do you have a booth over there?
Yes, I don't know exactly the name. I think 13 or so.
Okay, so you can find Frank in his booth. I want to thank you, Frank, for joining us today and sharing all your valuable knowledge with us.
Thank you very much.
And we also want to thank today our OSCC 17 sponsors, UC Irvine Institute for Virtual Environments and Computer Games, who support this grid, Rockcliffe University Consortium, Yippee-Ki-Yay Blues, Galactic Systems, Inc., Grid Phone, Loud LLC, Pure Power Streams for our audio stream, and Virtual Outwarding for its ongoing support of many of Avicon's programs and events. I also want to thank our many crowd founders and volunteers for making this event possible. So all the people that you see with the staff shirts, they're volunteering their time, so make sure to thank them along the way. Another reminder, the conference schedule can be found at conference.opensimulator.org. And following this session, our next session from 7:30, it starts at 7:30 a.m. It's called OAR Converter, Using Open Simulator and Unity as a Shared Development Environment for Social Virtual Reality Environments. Also, we encourage you to visit all of our expo regions. The OSCC 17 Poster Expo is on Expo 3 region, accompanying information on our presenters, and explore the Hypergrid Tour resources, which are located on Expo 2. Thanks again for everybody coming, and we'll be back in a little bit.